Good morning. I'm Jan Dick with the Minneapolis Heart Institute Foundation. Happy to have you here this morning. It's March 8th. Dr. Steve Bradley is going to fulfill us this morning. I want to thank Novartis. We have Eric and Kim who are here in person. So any of us who are here, please chat with them. And then they are also online. You will need to leave this Zoom meeting and go on the link that John's going to provide. So please thank them because it really does help make these grand rounds happen. So Dr. Bradley, thank you so much. You were with us on Saturday too for an event. So thanks for being here.
Good morning and thank you. This is the first time I've taken my mask off in a setting like this in a long time. Vaccinated, so I think it feels appropriate, but pleasure to be here with you this morning. I'm going to speak to you about the Cardiovascular Quality Improvement and Care Innovation Consortium. This is a concept that's gone from concept to reality in the span of the past 6 months or so, and something I'm really excited about that we here at MHI and HDI, the Healthcare Delivery Innovation Center, are leading as a national collaborative. My objectives today are to provide some background and understanding about why quality and innovation matter in healthcare, and my thoughts about why they particularly matter, what's currently lacking in quality improvement and care innovation, and how CV-QUIC, this quality improvement consortium, will be different in achieving change, and then what we're doing now, both as part of that collaborative and HDI leading work, both internally and as part of that collaborative. So when I was thinking about trying to explain my story of how I got interested in cardiovascular outcomes research, there are little moments of serendipity, and one happened in Seattle, and I realized one happened prior to Seattle that ended up me being in Seattle. So when I was applying for residency, I put Johns Hopkins first on my list. But when I went to Johns Hopkins to interview, one of the interviewers asked me where I was coming from. I was at the Medical College of Wisconsin in Milwaukee. And she said, "You're coming from Milwaukee?" I said, "Yes." And she started speaking more slowly, which I took as not a very good sign that I had a good chance at Johns Hopkins. But Seattle was my second choice. I ended up in Seattle. And I'm a little slow in the uptake in understanding who I need to kind of speak to or create relationships with to help me in my future professional career. And I knew that I had an interest in cardiology, but I hadn't kind of settled on it until I was actually a chief resident at Harborview Medical Center, which is their what we claim, the jewel, as former chief residents, the jewel of the crown of the Seattle training system. It's their county hospital where the residents truly run the show. And while I was a chief resident there, it really came to me why I was interested in cardiology, but I hadn't really spoken with anybody about it until I was actually meeting with Catherine Otto, her picture shown here, who's the program director for the cardiology training program in Seattle. She asked me, "Why do you want to go into cardiology?" And I said, "Well, we have all of this evidence in cardiology. We have created a tremendous amount of evidence relative to other fields. And it drives me crazy that we fail to apply what works in patients that it works for. And at the same time, we do things for patients that it won't work despite evidence that shows it won't work." She looked at me, she said, "You're describing outcomes research. You need to go talk to Steve Finn." I said, "I have no idea." "Okay, great." So it turned out that within Seattle, some of the leading people in outcomes research were there. I had not met them. His office was literally two doors down the hall from mine as a chief resident. So I met with Steve, who is the director of their outcomes training program at the VA, and did a health services outcomes research training program as part of my cardiology fellowship that gave me kind of the knocks to get to where I'm at today. So what is outcomes research and why does it matter? So outcomes research is the study of the end results of the healthcare system. So looking at what we do and saying, what do we achieve? What do we achieve in terms of outcomes relative to what we're hoping to achieve? And the goal is to increase the likelihood that patients achieve the outcomes they desire through better information, better decisions, and better healthcare delivery. When we think about components of what contribute to outcomes, the Institute of Medicine for developed their six components of high quality care: timely care, safe, effective, meaning we apply the therapies that work, efficient, patient-centered, and equitable. we clearly missed many of those opportunities. Some of those first were related to door to balloon for things like STEMI. When we think about equitability, clearly in our current healthcare system, we see the disparities in terms of what happens by race and ethnicity, even in COVID as it's happening currently. So clearly opportunities for us to do better. Another framework for thinking about outcomes research is one of value that was proposed by Michael Porter, who's actually a business professor at Harvard. So this is the outcomes we achieve relative to the cost of care that it takes us to achieve those outcomes. And if we can either improve outcomes while maintaining cost or maintain outcomes while lowering cost, we achieve better value for our patients. So why do quality and innovation matter? We don't achieve the ideal in terms of outcomes relative to the care we provide in the United States. If we look at healthcare costs per capita, we spend much, much more than other countries, and yet we fail to achieve the best outcome. So on the left side of the graph, we're looking at healthcare costs per capita with the United States leading the way by a margin of nearly $4,000 per capita. But when we look at life expectancy, worse being on the left, better being towards the right, we're kind of middle of the road to worse in all categories with the exception of heart attack mortality. And even there, we're not leading the pack. So there's clearly an opportunity for us to do better in achieving health outcomes in healthcare delivery. So again, focusing on those opportunities in timely, safe, effective, efficient, patient-centered, and equitable care, and how do we achieve better outcomes relative to the cost of care that we provide. So how do we actually achieve the promises of our healthcare? And that's where outcomes research comes in. So when we think about outcomes research, there are opportunities in discovery, so defining the determinants of outcomes. What is it in the care pathway that leads to us achieving the outcomes that we desire? Therapies that we can provide in a timely fashion to achieve the best outcomes for our patient. When we identify gaps in known therapies, it's identifying and assessing tools and strategies that yield patient-centered change. So what's necessary to achieve the outcomes we desire? A perfect example, again, is related to door to balloon time. There was seminal work by Elizabeth Bradley out of Yale, where she surveyed hospitals to determine what were the components that led to them achieving short door to balloon times. So it was things like EMS activation of the cath lab, going directly to the cath lab for patients who met STEMI criteria, a single page to members of the cath lab team so you weren't sending out multiple phone calls. It all seemed relatively straightforward work, but by identifying those components and tools, she was able to disseminate those to hospitals as part of an ACC, American College of Cardiology-led program that led to all hospitals improving in terms of achieving better door-to-balloon time. And then finally, surveillance. So patterns and trends in care, identifying opportunities for improvement and accountability for our efforts. So looking at the care that we achieve, identifying the gaps that persist, and finding out and thinking about how do we continue to address the gaps that persist in that care delivery. The challenge with health services and outcomes research is we tend to fall short of achieving the true goal of closing those gaps. We'll oftentimes describe the problem or surveil the problem, but we don't actually apply solutions to achieve the gap. These are quotes from Harlan Krumholtz, who is, if not the father, one of the founding figures of cardiovascular outcomes research. And his quotes and a summary paper included, "The research left unanswered the question about how to best remedy this safety issue." So the authors had described a safety issue as it related to certain therapies, including spironolactone and digoxin, and what was needed to be done to achieve the best outcomes relative to what had been previously been described in randomized trials. But then they failed to take the next step of what are the applications, what are the tools necessary to achieve those best outcomes, those promised outcomes. And similarly, after these disappointing studies, evidence is still lacking about how to best apply these lessons. So really a call for action for us to bridge that gap and move beyond just describing the problem and actually finding solutions to address these gaps. And one of the ways I've started to think about this, I learned this from Peter Ekman. He describes bird watching. So we went out and we counted the number of birds. That's an important thing to understand how many birds there are if you want to understand the population. The same way in outcomes research, it's important to do these discovery and surveillance studies of describing the problem. But we really need to go beyond description of the problem, closing the gap, providing solutions to achieve better outcomes. I was a traditional health services outcomes researcher in the VA healthcare system, and I was grant-supported, had done a lot of work describing outcomes related to appropriateness of PCI. We'd done some work in the state of Washington to actually close those gaps, but I really wanted to be engaged and involved in the solutions that were achieving those on a day-to-day basis for our health systems, for our patients, and for our country. And that's what led me to join Craig here at the at Minneapolis Heart Institute Healthcare Delivery Innovation Center. So Craig Strauss, also trained with the Masters of Public Health from Dartmouth, has the skill set to leverage data to identify opportunities to address gaps, unnecessary variation in healthcare through novel patient-centered solutions. And so that was the foundation of HDI, looking to optimize patient experience and health outcomes while reducing cost. So he had created the structure to leverage existing Allina data infrastructure, their electronic data warehouse, to look at clinical operation and analytics oversight to really think about the solutions to improve care, and was positioning Minneapolis Heart Institute and Allina as a national leader in healthcare change. And so it was in 2016 I'll take an additional step to say that the Healthcare Delivery Innovation Center is truly an example of a learning healthcare system. So for those who aren't familiar with the learning healthcare system, it's the idea that you look both internally and externally at what are the gaps and the opportunities and the problems that we need to address, designing solutions and implementing those, evaluating the impact of those solutions, and then adjusting and then sharing those results with your remaining community so others can do as well as you're doing. And so HDI is an example of that learning healthcare system as a result of having the infrastructure to do that type of work. We've got the data, so the electronic data warehouse that pulls in, I've heard 80, but I think it continues to grow, more than 80 sources of data in terms of clinical claims, billing, processes that inform us, our registry data that inform us about the care that we're providing, gaps in care and opportunities for us to do better, but then pulling that data together through analytic solutions that tell us where are the biggest opportunities and how do we and inform us about how we might address those opportunities. And then the real the meat of the solution is that it's not just about crunching the numbers and pointing out the problems, but that data analytics is partnered with clinical and operations to achieve improvement. So alignment of the data and analytics that identify the problem, the clinical solutions, and the operations to make these solutions work. As a result of that, Craig, when I had joined, was able to demonstrate more than $71 million in performance improvements as a result of avoiding unnecessary ICU admissions, avoiding unnecessary lab tests, reducing heart failure readmissions, hospital days avoided, better patient care, and fewer units of blood given. So it was that promise of HDI that really allured me to say, this is an opportunity for us to really move from bird watching to action to improving the quality and outcomes of care delivery. So that then leads to the question of, well, what continues to be lacking in quality improvement and care innovation? So this is great for HDI and for our healthcare center, but how do we achieve gaps, addressing gaps for the rest of the country and other settings? So there are a lot of existing strategies to address and identify gaps and try and do better. So existing strategies include benchmarking. So this is an example of benchmarking from the National Cardiovascular Data Registry for cath and PCI. So we get feedback reports on how we're doing for things like mortality. The STS registry is an example of that for cardiovascular surgery. The TVT registry is an example of that for valvular procedures. CMS has its own measures for things like heart failure readmissions. So how are we doing relative to others for us to try and achieve a standard and even do better than that standard? The problem is these benchmarks are limited in scope. They're focused on a single episode of care. They're condition-based, and they provide us no insights on the cost of care, patient satisfaction. So they have a limited opportunity in terms of informing our overall care. Outcomes research, I've already talked about some of the challenges of outcomes research. It's fantastic at identifying problems, but often fails to close the gap. Part of that problem is the health services and outcomes research world is often devoid of the clinical operations world. So they can point out a problem, but they may not be integrated with the care delivery in a way that they can provide a solution. I've heard it described of the cat bringing the dead mouse. So the cat brings to you this mouse of this gift, look what I've brought to you, but what is the healthcare system supposed to do with that without providing a solution that they can implement? And then finally, health systems are perpetually involved in quality improvement work, but it's often contained within the walls of that health system or that single center. And as a result, they may not be looking at it in terms of what is the design of that study or that quality improvement work that they can demonstrate the impact well, and it becomes not very well generalizable. A solution that works in one healthcare setting may not work in another healthcare setting without understanding the nuances of why it worked in that setting and how you transport it to another. So as someone who is a researcher, one of the reasons I was drawn to research was a conversation I had with Rick Page when I was a fellow at Seattle. Pete Aucar, who was one of my co-fellows, he was a nutrition nut. He was a vegan who had written two vegan cookbooks and was an electrophysiologist. And Pete wanted to meet with Dr. Page, who is also an electrophysiologist, to talk about how we could change the food in our cafeteria to be better for everyone who worked there and for our patients. And Pete wanted to pull me in to say, what can we kind of study as a result of this change? And I thought that was kind of a cool idea. And one of the things I was learning about was this concept of behavioral economics. It's essentially, if you grease the skids towards the better decision, you're more likely to make that better decision. So if we change the structure of how food is offered in the cafeteria, could we grease the skids towards people making better choices? So I was kind of pulled into that conversation. And one day while we were waiting for Pete to show up, Rick turned to me and said, you know, I really find the reward of research is having an impact on all the patients you'll never get to see. And I really thought that was pretty profound, right? So we can have tremendous impact on the patients we see face-to-face every day, but there's also an opportunity for us to do work that has impact on all the patients we'll never see. And so as a health services and outcomes researcher, I'm constantly thinking about how do we move from bird watching to action in outcomes research? How do we provide solutions that will have impacts on all the patients we'll never get to see and move beyond just describing those problems? And how do we leverage the enormous amount of work that's going on in individual healthcare settings, so systems like the Healthcare Delivery Innovation Center as part of MHI and Allina, to inform other centers to do better? And around that time, so my background, again, is a cardiovascular outcomes researcher. I was part of a community called the Quality of Care and Outcomes Research as part of the American Heart Association. They have an annual meeting where they talk about the science of quality and care and outcomes research. And I went to that meeting in 2018, and I found that it no longer spoke to me in the way that it used to. I used to really enjoy hearing about the gaps and the problems, but I was really drawn by the fact that I wasn't hearing about solutions. And it really was kind of driving me crazy to a degree. And at that meeting, I happened to find similar people who felt the same way. So Umesh Kote, who's in the top right corner, director of quality for the Cleveland Clinic Cardiovascular Programs, was at that meeting and we had a conversation. He said, you know, I'm really interested in finding the opportunities to do something. We need to find the doers. And he referred to that concept of finding the doers, the people who weren't just describing the problem, but finding solutions to do better. Ty Gluckman, who top left corner, director of quality for Providence Health Systems Cardiovascular Programs. Similarly, he is involved in a research effort as part of a quality improvement and outcomes research program that's part of Providence, but really in charge of finding solutions to do better in healthcare delivery for cardiovascular care at Providence. Joe Emminger, who is in the top middle at Cedars-Sinai, is a junior faculty member and just kind of percolating up into a role of leading quality improvement for Cedars-Sinai and very interested in finding solutions in his programs and systems. Sandeep Das, who's middle right at UT Southwestern, similarly involved in quality improvement programs for UT Southwestern, actually went on and got an MBA so he could speak the language of his financial and operational partners to try and understand what were the language and what were the words that would sell the importance of quality and outcomes to the folks that would write the checks. Conan, who is middle left, is at Northwestern. He's a heart failure and critical care doc who's done a lot of work in thinking about opportunities to improve flow of patients through his system. Mike Ho, who's bottom left, was my friend and colleague in Colorado. Very much a health outcomes researcher, but being pulled increasingly into his health system to find solutions to achieve better outcomes at lower cost for the University of Colorado Health System. And Divya Gupta, who's middle bottom, she's a heart failure doctor at Emory. She's another junior member who's percolating up in her system to identify opportunities for quality improvement. So here were people who were trained in health services and outcomes research, or were actually developing those skills along the side, and he'd either transition from a health services and outcomes research to a clinical operation focused opportunity, similar to what I had done, or were clinical operations and kind of building their health services and outcomes research. So here were the doers that were interested in the same types of things in an opportunity to think about how do we collaborate together to identify where are the things that we can do differently to address the continuing gaps, moving beyond benchmarks, moving beyond registries, moving beyond traditional health services and outcomes research of just describing the problem and coming up with the solutions. And similarly, sharing what we're doing at individual centers in a way that becomes something we can disseminate across our centers and across the country. So the concept began in June of 2018 after that initial call or that initial meeting at the American Heart Association where we happened to be standing in a bar and having these conversations. So we held a conference call in June that summer to try and understand how we could come together. And our objectives at first were to learn about ongoing quality and care improvement opportunities in cardiovascular disease, finding outlets to share our work, and identifying others who are interested in adapting and adopting our work. And we focused on first having a teleconference every 3 months where we would share our previously completed quality improvement and care innovation projects for individual sites. And the focus was on minimizing presentation time. We didn't want a half an hour presentation. We wanted to hear the concept, what they had done, and then have a conversation about how could we export that concept to our own healthcare system so that we could do similarly well. These are the projects that we discussed in the first year. So Conan was amongst our first participants. So as a health failure doc, he was really focused on how can we improve the transition of patients out of the hospital. And the idea that patients who are seen soon after discharge are less likely to be readmitted. So they worked on approaches to making sure that they could manage that need for follow-up. They applied what's called queuing theory to match the needs of follow-up relative to the supply that they had. And as a result of applying that approach, they improved their heart failure follow-up within 14 days from 43% to 93%. Appropriate telemetry utilization. So Ty Gluckman had learned from folks at Geisinger Healthcare System about an approach that they had used to reduce telemetry utilization by applying a nurse-led protocol that would identify when the patient had met criteria to come off of telemetry by standard guideline recommendations. And by applying that nurse-led program had reduced telemetry monitoring by 20%. This is one of those examples where individual institutional type of effects can be important. So at Providence and Geisinger, they got buy-in for the concept of a nurse-led program to reduce telemetry utilization by following a protocol. That similar approach, when initially presented locally here, met pushback that nurses shouldn't be responsible for essentially determining when a patient could come off telemetry. And so the alternative was to build in the same protocols of what are the guidelines say about when a patient should come off telemetry and instead put in best practice alerts that would alert the provider. What happened is there's been no change in telemetry utilization whatsoever. And in fact, the providers have pushed back and said, these best practice alerts are driving me crazy. So again, a similar gap, a similar opportunity, but a different solution and a different outcome. So by having these conversations and sharing our experiences allows us to then come back and say, okay, so these are other health systems that are applying a different approach. Rather than putting it on the physicians and responding to a best practice alert, they're putting in best practices led by a nurse algorithm that has pop-offs to say if you fall outside of this to connect with the physician. And in doing that, they've reduced their telemetry utilization, maintained patient safety. And by having those conversations, we can now have conversations with their own health system and are starting to move in that potential direction. Integration of high sensitivity troponin. So this is work led by Sandeep Das and the Parkland Healthcare System. So a chest pain protocol that leveraged high sensitivity troponin and change in the first hour to reduce the length of stay, increase patient throughput, and ensure patient safety. Optimal use of sternal plating. So this is work that we had done here where we demonstrated variation in the use of sternal plates after cardiac surgery. We demonstrated that there was no significant difference in patient outcomes relative to that sternal plating, and conversations with our surgical colleagues reduced the use of sternal plating at a cost savings while maintaining clinical outcomes. Heart failure checklist. So this was work led by Umesh Kote that actually won the HIMSS award for the year that he presented this. So a checklist intended to optimize heart failure discharge, and then in optimizing that discharge, a reduction in heart failure readmission from 21 to 18%. And then finally, work from Emory with Divya Gupta, looking at initial diuretic dosing for acute decompensated heart failure. So I'm going to spend some specific time on this project, so I'll gloss over it currently, but this is one of those projects where, as a result of having this conversation, we identified an opportunity that we otherwise wouldn't have thought of, and now we're taking this across our collaborative. So how will CV-QUIC be different in achieving change? So we published our kind of introduction of who we are earlier this year. Our vision is perfect cardiovascular care. Our mission is to rapidly improve cardiovascular care through the development, validation, and dissemination of novel strategies and care delivery design. Since our inception of those eight centers, we've added an additional seven, so we're up to 15 centers in the span of less than essentially a year, collaboratively working together towards these goals. We see this collaborative as a scalable framework for cardiovascular quality improvement and care innovation. Again, formally conceptualized in June of 2019, we're defining success as this group being recognized as the home of pragmatic cardiovascular quality improvement efforts, and by identifying projects that result in changes to care delivery with demonstrable impacts on the quality and outcomes of care across multiple health systems. We see three potential areas of opportunity. One, that idea of developing, implementing, and evaluating multi-center projects using innovative care designs. Two, being a resource for partners. So I talked about how health services and outcomes researchers oftentimes lack the clinical buy-in or the clinical tie-in to develop the solutions. We want to be those partners for those healthcare, for those health outcomes researchers. Similarly, there are many startup companies in innovation and healthcare technology that lack the clinical partners to guide them insights about how you actually would put this into clinical practice, their solutions into clinical practice. And then finally, establishing a presence within existing quality improvement and care innovation structures. I want to first focus on this first area of developing, implementing, and evaluating multi-center projects. I'm going to focus on that project that Divya brought to us related to initial diuretic dosing as an example opportunity of how this collaborative might work together to achieve that goal. So in 2011, the DOSE trial was published in the New England Journal of Medicine. This was essentially a multifactorial trial comparing high dose to low dose initial diuretic dosing and bolus versus continuous drip. High dose was defined by they received 2.5 times their home dose being their 24-hour dose of a loop diuretic and furosemide equivalents. Low dose was essentially equivalent to their home dose in an IV therapy. This trial was a negative trial for its primary outcome, which is how was the patient feeling at 72 hours as it related to shortness of breath symptoms. But subgroups or sub-analyses demonstrated that there was more rapid decongestion in terms of fluid off, weight change, and a shorter length of stay in the patients that received the higher dose diuretics. Emory looked at this trial and said, I wonder what our initial diuretic dosing looks like in our health system. And they found that about half of the patients who came into the hospital, their initial diuretic dose was equivalent to or lower than their home dose of diuretics. Those patients that received an equivalent or lower home dose of diuretics had an additional 1 day length of stay. That's a big opportunity. So we wanted to we learned from Divya and we said, well, I wonder what the opportunity is for Allina and Abbott Northwestern Hospital. So we did a similar analysis where we took the population of patients who were admitted for a primary or secondary diagnosis of congestive heart failure. We excluded patients who did not receive an IV diuretic in the first 24 hours. So if they were admitted for heart failure but didn't receive an IV diuretic to us, that was a signal that part of their the admission diagnosis wasn't really reflective of what was happening in their clinical care. If they received an IV diuretic, we presume that part of their hospital care was to diurese that patient. We used the diuretic dosing logic that was applied in the DOSE trial and then compared the initial dose to half of their home dose, same as what would have been done in the DOSE trial. And what we found was similar to what Divya found. So we're looking, you can focus on the grand total. About half of patients received an initial dose that was above their home dose. About a quarter received a dose that was equivalent to, and about a quarter received a dose that was below their home dose. And if you look at the length of stay, there's essentially a dose-response relationship. If you got a dose above your home dose, 6.2 7 days length of stay, equivalent to 6.74 and below 7.56. So a similar 1 day length of stay difference for half of the population that may be eligible. So in summary, half of patients treated within the linear system receive an additional diuretic that is equivalent to or lower than their home dose and is associated with an additional length of stay. One of the things that's important when we do quality improvement work is to recognize that this isn't research data. This isn't truth per se, but it's a signal of the opportunity. It may be that some of these patients, and almost certainly is, that some of these patients have very reasonable reasons why they didn't receive an initial diuretic that's above their home dose. But even if we assume that only half of this gap or half of this opportunity is actionable and real, that still comes out to 1,300 avoidable bed days at a $500,000 cost savings. And that's just for Abbott, Mercy, and United. Across our system, it would be different. So we took this to our hospital as partners, recognizing oftentimes they're the first persons that will see the patients in the hospital and are the drivers of that initial dose. And we said, what do you think about this opportunity? They were excited, but they said, you know what? I bet you there's also an opportunity in the emergency department. We oftentimes receive patients on the floor who have not received a diuretic in the emergency department, or if they receive it, it's a lower dose that we would even give. So we took it the next step forward and said, what's the initial diuretic look like in the emergency department? And similarly, we see that half of patients who in the emergency department don't receive an initial diuretic dose that you would like, and even actually buried within this, some further work we've done is to show that a third of patients receive no diuretic in the emergency department. So clearly opportunities, and we see the same dose response relationship of the higher the dose, the lower the length of stay. This just applied to Abbott Northwestern, 350 avoidable bed days. So began to feel confident that there was a possible opportunity and impact of early initiation of therapeutic diuretic dose. Locally, we've taken this to our health system through our hospitalists and our emergency departments. The hospitalists have what they're calling H-QUIC. So Love Patel is leading a hospitalist quality improvement and care innovation program. We came up with the idea of CV-QUIC and H-QUIC independently. We named them independently. We just happened to come across the same solutions. But Love Patel and this group have leaders of the hospitals at each of the regional hospitals that participate in conversations about opportunities for quality improvement and care innovation. We took this to them and have shared with them opportunities to address underdosing of diuresis. We've asked the hospitalists to, similarly, when they have conversations in admitting the patients to from the emergency department, to have conversations with the emergency department about what was the initial dose of diuretic and trigger as a reminder to achieve a higher dose. We've had conversations with emergency department leadership. So we've both at a system and at each individual emergency department had conversations about what is our current what do our data look like currently? Where's the opportunity? And then finally with pharmacy about changing our orders to reflect what would an equivalent dose of diuretic look like and what should a goal diuretic look like for initial diuresis. To try and provide audit and feedback and action, we're providing run reports and feedback. We started this late January, early February of this year. So providing run reports, and I'll show an example of that from another project that we're doing that's had impact. This is that example. So this is work we've done similarly with our hospitalist colleagues looking at venous thromboembolism prophylaxis. So for patients who are admitted with a medical diagnosis who are short length of stay and observation stay in the hospital for a short period of time, there's no benefit to venous thromboembolism prophylaxis and potential harm, both in terms of things like sequential squeezers being associated with increased risk of fall, and medications not being of benefit. So there's an opportunity where we're potentially using therapies to no outcome benefit, an opportunity to reduce costs while maintaining outcomes. So in conversations with the hospitalists and providing run reports, we've shown a dramatic decrease in the use of things like squeezers over the past year while maintaining optimal patient outcomes. And this has a savings on the order of more than $1 million a year for the health system. Similar opportunity in diuretic dosing. So we'll provide similar run reports of what proportion of patients received an initial diuretic at above that home diuretic dose, and what is the impact in terms of length of stay over time. So how do we take that opportunity and then build it towards a multi-center opportunity? So here's Divya, who's taken this idea. We've glommed onto it. We now want to get our collaborative involved to demonstrate at multi-centers what's the opportunity look like in terms of its size? What are potential solutions that people can put into place, and what does that have as an impact in outcomes? The first is to have a shared process of how we identify these patients. So all of the centers that I mentioned have processes by which they can capture data either directly from Epic through something called Clarity or through their own electronic data warehouse. And by sharing our process of who's the cohort of interest, we can come to similar agreements of looking at our populations. So to the right, you can see the flow chart of how we've identified our patient population here for MHI and Allina, and we've shared that approach with our colleagues at Emory, Colorado, Providence Health System, so they can identify the same cohort of patients so we can first be comparing apples and apples in terms of cohort. The next is to have a similar definition in terms of exposure and outcomes. So using that dose trial as the exposure, so we have agreement on the exposure, and then agreement on the outcomes. We're using length of stay and acute kidney injury as our primary outcomes. Acute kidney injury defined by what's called the Aiken criteria, so the change in their creatinine, looking at admission to peak creatinine during their hospital stay. And these are data actually from our initial analysis that suggest similarly, again, that length of stay reduction, but no difference in acute kidney injury between these populations. So at least on the face of it, no suggestion that higher doses are associated with an increased risk of harm to the patient. So by creating that shared approach, we can then take it to our colleagues to run these analyses at our local centers and start to develop these multi-center innovation projects. One of the hopes is that we can then come to a generalizable solution or a generalizable effect size. Again, if we demonstrate this in Allina, that's a wonderful thing, but if we can demonstrate this across 15 centers, the impact of addressing initial diuretic dosing, that has a much stronger impact. And then finally, tailored to the environment. So we're an Epic system. We have Epic orders that we're all familiar with. There's an opportunity to think about embedding clinical decision support. This is an example of some of the text that's been proposed about approximate loop diuretic equivalency doses that would be provided to the provider and guidance about what an initial dose might look like. Systems that aren't on Epic or have different structures are going to need to tailor their solutions differently. And we can compare the impact of those different solutions across our centers. And our hope is to address what's been called that gap in quality improvement research. So this is from a paper, an editorial that was published in JAMA Internal Medicine a little over 2 years ago that talked about persistent gaps in quality improvement research that lead to a lack of interest in publishing or sharing some of these works. One is that there's lack of a concurrent control group, so nothing to compare to. By having these different centers that will implement their solutions at different times, we've essentially got some control groups built in. We can look at the work that we do that we're implementing here now in January of 2021, and other sites that roll on later will have essentially their trend in use of initial diuretic dosing and length of stay will serve as a bit of a comparator and control group for us. Blinding outcomes assessment and randomization where possible. I don't think randomization is something that oftentimes you'll hear the health services and outcomes researchers talk about as the ideal. I think it's very, very challenging in clinical practice. We have to think about different analytic structures that allow us to really get a sense of the effect size of our work. And then finally, results that are generalizable. Impact in one center or system is insufficient. So here we're really working towards what is that impact across multiple centers. Some of the ways we can do that analytically is what's called a difference in difference analysis. So a lot of things are improving in healthcare regardless of what we're doing. So we have to be careful in before and after comparisons because the trends will just make it look like we do better if we compare two different points in time. We really need to look at that slope, that change over time, and say at a certain point in time where we put in an intervention, do we change the angle of that slope or do we create a gap? So that difference in difference. And another component of this that you'll hear health services and outcomes researchers talk about is creating data structures where we're all sharing our data together. To me, that's an unrealistic solution if we really want to move the needle quickly. You can spend 5 to 10 years working entirely on the data structures. There are systems that have done that. So we are part of what's called the PCORI network, this concept of creating a data infrastructure across centers so you can compare apples and apples. They've spent, well, that was part of the ACA. So I suppose close to 10 years building out that data infrastructure. And there's been very little output from that. And we need to make change now. A different approach would be to say that centers keep their data in-house, they analyze it in-house, and we use things like meta-analytic methods to compare the effect size across site and have some sense of
what's the overall effect size. There's not the need for that data infrastructure. There's a need for agreement on definitions, but it allows us to overcome some of those data barriers to actually move forward more quickly. So that's describing our approach to these multi-center projects, how we hope to deliver them. We also hope to be a partner for care innovation partners. I've spoken about the outcomes researcher that sometimes has difficulty overcoming the hurdle between research and practice. We hope to walk together with our health services and outcomes research partners to help them implement some of their ideas into practice. Similarly, there's tremendous investment in health technology, but oftentimes those health technology partners lack the clinical partners who have insights about how these things might work in operations or clinical practice, and we hope to be those partners as well. Establishing a presence within existing structures was our third aim. This is a picture after we presented at the American Heart Association Quality of Care and Outcomes Research meeting in 2019. So again, looking to be the home of pragmatic quality improvement and care innovation within this community of outcomes researchers. We will again be presenting at AHA in 2021, and we've started to build out a training program for residents and fellows who want to learn the skill set necessary for quality improvement and care innovation work. So with that, I'll move on to what are we doing now. I'll briefly talk about other areas that CV-QUIC is involved in. We've built a website to start to establish a presence for our outside community to begin to recognize us as the home of pragmatic quality improvement work. Joe Emminger has an interest in hypertension, in particular resistant hypertension, that works in well into opportunities to think about population health and ways we can address hypertension more globally through identification of patients with hypertension with persistent non-addressed hypertension and different strategies of achieving care. And then atrial fibrillation discharge from the ED. This is actually work that was informed by our colleagues in electrophysiology that did work to look at patients who were discharged from the emergency department with a diagnosis of atrial fibrillation and found half of those patients had no evidence of cardiology follow-up in the first month after their discharge, and half of those patients with a CHADS2 VAS score of 2 weren't on an anticoagulant. They were inappropriately treated for their risk of stroke. So addressing those gaps and thinking about solutions is something we're also working with collaboratively to work on. I want to transition from the collaborative now more focused on the Healthcare Delivery Innovation Center itself and some of the work we're doing just in the recent past couple months. So we're starting to think differently about how we address quality gaps. A lot of efforts to address quality gaps are focused on clinical decision support and quality triggers that are built on a push. So we build in our data infrastructure ways that we identify that there's a gap in care, and we push providers to do something differently about it. We say, this patient was admitted for an MI. Why aren't they on a beta blocker? This patient has such and such. Why aren't they? And oftentimes, there's good reasons why they're not, and so these alerts come up, and we start to get fatigued about them because it's not the right application. It's the wrong time to be reminded, and there's so many that we just click through them. And actually, there's data to suggest that the vast majority, upwards of 95% of best practice alerts, are blatantly ignored. So they're not having an impact. They're just annoying the living daylights out of us. So can we change from a push to creating pull in quality improvement to achieve better outcomes for our patients? And that's some of the work that we've done to first demonstrate why these pushes don't work. So this is work that we did in collaboration with Peter Ekman and the Heart Failure Service to look at gaps in the use of resynchronization therapy. We used the Alina EDW data to identify patients with a reduced ejection fraction and then a persistently reduced ejection fraction with a prolonged QRS. We used a very sensitive definition. We could have been more specific, but we wanted to identify the largest eligible population at first. And then excluded patients who either died, received it subsequently, their EF improved, really leveraging our data to say who might be eligible. When we did that, we came up with 26% of patients, 377 patients, who had an apparent gap in resynchronization use. That means that of your patients that you see with heart failure with a reduced ejection fraction in your clinic, about 1 in 4 would pop up. If you were to put in a best practice alert for this practice, about 1 in 4 would pop up saying that there's apparent underuse of the CRT therapy. We then went and did detailed chart review of these 26% of patients and found that in actuality, only 7% were truly eligible. Either it had been discussed and the patient said they didn't want it, or they had significant comorbidities, or other reasons why CRT was not an appropriate therapy for this patient. So the real gap from that process was 7%. Shows that if we had applied a best practice alert 3 out of 4 times, it would have triggered us about something that really wasn't actionable. It would have added to that 95% of best practice alerts that we just ignore because they're not helpful. To take it even further, of those, that 7% was 83 patients. We provided that information to the 41 providers who were caring for those 83 patients. And those providers came back to us and said, yeah, 21 of those patients are something we improved upon. Thank you for letting me know. Let's get them set up for CRT. But that really means that the true gap was only 1.7%. That's a lot of effort to get to those 1.7%. I heard it said this weekend that, you know, for somebody who doesn't die, it's a pretty big deal for that one person. So for these individuals, it's a big thing that we've closed this gap. But it speaks to the challenge of how do we create solutions that address these gaps that in our data look like 1 in 4, but in actuality are 1 in 50. So we've started to think differently about, instead of pushes, how can we create pulls to think really about selected populations where getting them in the right patient hands might help us? And how can we take this out of the hands of perhaps a primary care provider who's going to get 50 best practice alerts and instead create an easy button, per se, to get them to the right patient, right people to care for them? One example is this patient's discharged from the emergency department with AFib. Again, 50% without clinical follow-up, 50% not anticoagulated. We've leveraged our data to identify who these patients are and are providing these lists to an EP-APP for Abbott Northwestern for hospitals that refer to us, and to United for hospitals that refer to United's electrophysiology programs, to review them and say, are they appropriate for general cardiology because they've never seen a cardiologist, don't have an established relationship, or are they someone who's followed with general cardiology but this is their fourth visit to the emergency department in the past year and perhaps we should bump up to having them see an electrophysiologist. The volume of patients that we're having them review is on the order of 4 to 6 patients per week, so that's one patient per day. That's a very different volume than if you were to put this in the hands of either the emergency room physician or a primary care provider where, again, perhaps 1 in 50 times is that push really helpful. We've just put this into place, and we'll start to evaluate the impact of this type of work in the coming year. Similarly, there may be an opportunity in patients with severe aortic stenosis. If we look at patients who have a diagnosis of severe aortic stenosis by the echocardiogram, we have approximately 50 patients a year with no cardiology follow-up. Again, it could be that some of these patients get their echo in our system and go elsewhere. It could be that they get their echo by, I know that I shared this with Santiago Garcia, and he looked at a patient who had an echo by an orthopedic surgeon prior to surgery, and there's no clear evidence that they had kind of the follow-up they need. Can we create the pull to get that patient into the valve team without necessarily pushing a provider? Can we reach out to the primary care provider and say, we just reviewed their echocardiogram, they've got severe aortic stenosis, can we help you by getting them into the clinic? And instead of putting it on the provider to make those pathways and connect the buttons, pull that patient towards us. And then finally, a similar opportunity in heart failure. There's a lot of thought that there's populations of patients with heart failure who would benefit from advanced heart failure therapy or advanced heart failure providers. The question is, what's the right threshold and what's the approach to identifying those patients so we get real return? A recent analysis we did demonstrated that about 81 patients per year with persistently reduced ejection fraction are hospitalized. And those may be patients who are at particularly high risk where consultation or involvement of the advanced heart failure team could help, and pulling them into either the CHAMP clinic or our heart failure providers could be helpful. So again, thinking about pathways to pull patients to the clinical experts, important for achieving optimal outcomes and perhaps for growth of our practice. I'll end with some thoughts about where else we need to be. So about 80% of Americans have smartphones, and every time I review this data, it increases, and I didn't review it in the past year, so it's probably upwards of 90% now. Many of these are integrated with smart devices, but they're underutilized to support healthcare. We also have changing expectations in our patient populations, and after COVID, that's going to change even more. And we're moving away from episodic care, where it's focused on the walls of where we provide our care, to more continuous, including at the home. So how do we think about that? One way is to think about the healthcare consumer journey and ways in which we leverage technology and digital strategies to help with that care journey. This is part of the information that informed our work related to the Take Heart app, which is the app we've developed to help patients in their care journey for cath and PCI and TAVR that was just rolled out this past week and actually was highlighted on KSDP news at 5:30 and 10 o'clock last night. So we've worked on approaches to providing convenient access and efficient care delivery by connecting patients to MHI and MHI to patients. We focused first on that app, but we've recently been doing work working with our partners in the business office and Andrea Berg about how can we improve our website, our search engine optimization, so that when people look for us online, they find us. I remember showing this to some folks previously, and when you search Minneapolis Heart Institute, we are not the first thing that comes up, and our providers are not necessarily the first thing that comes up either. How to navigate our system, opportunities for online online scheduling for patients for follow-up visits. How can we take our intake forms that are all paper and actually digitize them in a way that flows into our patient records and informs what needs to happen in their patient care? All work that we're doing in partnership with our business office, our in Allina's digital experience team. When it comes to the app, we first focused on ways that we could focus on care pathways. We wanted to bring something to the patient that other things, other apps or other approaches wouldn't necessarily bring. We felt that point of care in their fingertips, guidance, and what needs to happen in their care journey for a procedure would be helpful. We first focused on coronary angiogram and PCI. This is an in-demand procedure and has specific content to improve care. And then this served as a readily extensible pathway to other care, such as TAVR, that we've since developed and implemented. So this is the minimal lovable product. I'll actually be speaking about the Take Care app is at one of our coming group meetings on a Tuesday, so I'll show you exactly how the app works. And our nurses are onboarding patients to this app when they're getting prepared for cath and PCI or TAVR. The first patient to get it was one of mine, a 78-year-old woman who underwent coronary angiogram. Turned out she didn't have obstructive disease. She loved it. She was able to flip through this thing better than our nurses were. She really understood how the technology was helping her. And when she was on the procedural floor, she was showing the nurses there. She was like, look at how great this app is. I heard back from folks on the procedural unit about how much she enjoyed it. So really successful and really great to see this moving forward and now part of our practice. And then finally, I'll touch on how I think this can build into remote care programs. So we've known for close to a decade that there are opportunities to leverage things like remote blood pressure monitoring, including pharmacist-led remote management of hypertension. The challenge has often been how do you create a structure that's financially viable in a fee-for-service environment, but that's changing as we move towards population health and more risk-based approaches to reimbursement. So there may be opportunities to think about how do we leverage Take Heart or a program like Take Heart that's a care journey to extend that care journey to things that have longer care journeys, if you will, like initial management of hypertension. Similarly, remote cardiac rehab programs that had existing cardiac rehab programs, some of them were able to leverage those quickly during COVID to develop a remote cardiac rehab. This might serve as a strategy for a group like us that does not currently have a brick and mortar part of cardiac rehab, at least at Minneapolis Heart Institute, Abbott Northwestern, to leverage technology to provide cardiac rehab at home. And there's good evidence to suggest that the outcomes are similar with at home versus brick and mortar based cardiac rehab. And then finally, thinking about strategies to leverage remote care programs for rapid up titration of heart failure medications. If we have the right data infrastructures pulling in, it's possible that we can get patients up to their optimal therapies without necessarily needing to see them in clinic every 2 weeks, but actually doing that remotely. And I'll just quickly touch on it again. This is the way that we can leverage data within HDI and Allina to identify where are the patients that might fit these programs. This is work that we did soon after the development of the new hypertension guidelines to show who are the patients, where do they live, where are the opportunities as it relates to opportunities to improve health, hypertension care. I'll end with a question. Are we moving from dream to reality? This, again, was from Harlan Krumholtz in 2008 when he said, we could be entering an era in which we conduct virtually real-time research with expansive and responsive surveillance systems with the ability to evaluate rapidly the adoption and effects of innovations in care. Now, could be entering an era. I don't know what his timeline was. My guess is he thought that we were kind of on the cusp of it. I don't think that we're anywhere close to where he thought we envisioned we would hopefully be. There are a lot of reasons why this is challenging, but we hope to be part of the solution by thinking about that pragmatic component of addressing gaps, working together to achieve solutions and achieve better outcomes for our patients. So in conclusion, outcomes research can help achieve the promise of ideal health care through discovery, application, and surveillance of the end results of our care. CV-QUIC, this collaborative that we're leading, is poised to lead rapid improvements through a pragmatic, multi-centered approach that addresses gaps in quality improvement and care innovation. And finally, we here at Minneapolis Heart Institute and Healthcare Delivery Innovation Center are leading this change nationally in the development and implementation of novel solutions. And it's really been a pleasure to speak with you this morning, and I welcome your questions.
Steve, thank you. I learned a lot of new things like difference and differences. That's a new one for me, but that was a great presentation. I wonder how you go about identifying these projects in the very first place. In other words, what are your criteria for looking at these things and just your thoughts on that?
Yeah, so I think it's a combination of things. I showed that picture of the learning healthcare system. So it's a combination of internal and external surveillance to say where are the pain points, where are the opportunities. Some of these are a little bit serendipitous. Some are to say we recognize that this is we know this is an opportunity. Where are the pieces of the puzzle we can get at? Obviously, heart failure is an incredibly common reason patients are admitted to the hospital, an incredibly common component of the cost of healthcare delivery. And anything that we can do to shave off pieces of that is going to have a big impact on our patients and our costs. So that kind of meets the criteria. And not only that, but we've got the data infrastructure we need to address those problems. Similarly, hypertension, very common problem. When we thought about the resistant hypertension, that's a little bit of a niche problem. But understanding that informs the bigger aspect of who are our populations with hypertension, where are they, how are their opportunities. So by addressing the niche, it builds out the foundation for the larger work. So I don't know that there's magic to it that I can explain other than to say that it's got to be a big problem that the data is going to address, a big solution. It can't be some kind of nuanced thing. The data structure needs to be there to help us inform the problem. I know that I remember when I was at the VA in Denver, I'd have fellows oftentimes who would come to me about questions of use of aspirin. Aspirin's an over-the-counter therapy, and so the data infrastructure doesn't support our understanding of addressing that gap. And similarly, the impact is probably not as large as we'd want to focus in on. So those are the types of things that we think through as we identify our opportunities. Yes?
Just a few online comments and questions, excuse me. The first comment is from Dr. Katsianis, who says, fantastic presentation, with a follow-up question of, where do you think health system leaders across the U.S. are at with recognizing and supporting this type of work?
Health system leaders, I think that's a great question. I think one of the things that, and I'll say Craig has done incredibly well, is to tie the dollars to the quality improvement, to demonstrate what the impact of quality improvement and care innovation has in terms of the financial return. I think oftentimes when we talk about things like safety or preventing falls, it's appropriately focused in the guise of how are we helping patients, but then we fail to make the tie of what is the financial impact that's having on our health system so we can do more of this work, right? So by creating the financial umbrella of how this impacts our system, we then create the drive to do more of this work. And so I think this group of, I'll use again Umesh's word, the doers, part of what we're doing is really focusing on where are those opportunities that create the financial incentive for us to continue to do more of this work. So I think it requires more people like Craig, like Umesh, like these leaders to say, this is important not only for the impact of what it's doing for our individual patients and for us to achieve best outcomes, but this is important for our mission of lowering costs as we address the financial pressures of our systems. So that's my sense, and I think that more people are coming around to a realization of how these things are tied together. Yes.
I got a great presentation, Steve, and this is really important work. I have kind of an easy question for you and a hard question for you. Because this is important work and it's good research, is this work being published under the name of the Minneapolis Heart Institute Foundation? That's my easy one, and kind of why or why not? And then second of all, I think that the gap between research and practice, that hurdle is cultural change. And I just wonder if your group is discussing, how do you change the culture of an organization to be aligned with you know, this movement. In a similar way, it seems like as an organization, we kind of have a new theme every few years, and right now the theme is safety culture. You know, how do you get this quality culture kind of embedded in who you are?
Yeah, so I'll take that as three questions. One, is this published under Minneapolis Heart Institute Foundation? So yes, I mean, when I publish it, it's under Minneapolis Heart Institute Foundation. The name of the organization is not the Minneapolis Heart Institute Foundation CV-QUIC. It's CV-QUIC with my leadership as part of the foundation. So I guess the answer is yes. Two was, culture was the third part, but two, what was two? Oh, the bridge between research and practice and being a cultural one. I guess I see it slightly different in the sense that I think we all, how to respond to that one? I guess I see it more of the researchers and the practitioners are kind of looking at it from different lenses. The researcher is identifying the problem, but then is not, they're not incentivized to create the solutions that are embedded in the research because they're not funded by the operational and clinical partners. And so there's a disconnect between kind of what the priorities are. We need to shift the priorities away from kind of describing the problem theoretical to actually creating solutions, I think is one of the issues. And so that's more of the prioritization of the folks who are thinking about these problems and helping them move away from a prioritization of papers that describe problems to incentives to come up with solutions. And again, if you think about where some of these folks that are thinking about these problems, if they're not part of a healthcare system that's saying, we need you to create solutions to these problems to address this for our health system, and instead they're focused on creating papers, it's a lot easier to get papers out that describe problems than it is to create solutions that take years. So I think there's a disconnect there. And then finally, how do you address culture? That's a fantastic question, and part of what we've talked about within CV-QUIC is incorporating aspects of what we learn from our partners in business and what we learn from understanding culture and change and change management, because that is a component of it. We'll take some of those skill sets in. We haven't run into a problem yet that is really more of a cultural change problem, but I'm certain that we will.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you.